evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening's performance. It's an absolute delight to see so many people here. We had no idea so many people would come, but it's a real pleasure to see you all here. This is going to be a concert performance of a 1955 Egyptian classic, Lahn al-Wafa. We think it's a first. We think it's a first in the sense that this is the first time that this piece of music has been performed with an orchestra and with a full orchestration. The orchestration has been done by our students here at King's, and it's been a labor of love. We're going to do a little bit of talking first, because we wanted, as well as to play the music, to communicate a little bit to you about why this music, why we think, at least, that this music and that this whole cultural moment still matters. And joining me on the panel here are my colleague here at King's, Professor of Comparative Literature, Ziad Al-Malsafi, on my right, and on my left, Reem Abul-Fadl, who teaches politics at SOAS. It's a delight to have them here joining me. This concert and event wouldn't have happened had not a certain trail of connections taken place. And the very first started with Oxford Maqam, my own ensemble. And I should have also introduced myself. I'm Martin Stokes. I teach music here at King's. Our Oxford Maqam ensemble star vocalist Tariq Bashir and Yara Salahuddin were very quick to say, this is possible, and yes, we want to do it. So that was one starting point. The next issue was finding an orchestra, and I was delighted to have immediately at hand the King's Philharmonic Orchestra under the estimable leadership of Bertram Yap and Brian Chewy. They're also going to be conducted today by Raymond Hung. So I'm very grateful to the speed with which they stepped forward and threw themselves into this madcap adventure. The next thing that we needed was a jazz sound. The King's Big Band were next to step forward with great enthusiasm and great spirit, and they are joined by a very distinguished rhythm section, including William South on the piano and Ollie Steadman on the bass. There are a lot of people here, you're going to see a lot of people on the stage, and I want to thank all of them for just being up for this. It's been an adventure pulling it all together. I also want to thank the A&H, the Arts and Humanities team here at King's, and those associated with the Fabrication Festival for encouraging us to do this, and thanks to Pelagia Pais and Alex as well for all of the work that they've put into this. I'm going to say very little because my hands are already starting to tingle and get a little bit sweaty because I've got to do some playing. So I'm going to hand over to my fellow speakers very quickly. But I did want to say a few words about the spirit in which I'm approaching this evening. Lahn al-Wafa, a film with this big kind of operetta-like number at the end. It was produced in 1955. It's fairly well known to many of the people sitting here in the audience. I take it at a certain level as a kind of Nasserite allegory of the nation brought together in love, affection, reasonableness, and the family bond. My approach to this music is a musical approach. I approach it as a musical topic, a musical fabrication, if you will, to borrow the name of this festival. Like many of the films in which al-Halim, Hafiz, starts, it's about music making, it's about the production of the operetta that finishes the film itself. So it's very much a story about musical fabrication and the fabrication of music. It's melodramatic fabrication in the extreme. We have here a melodramatic conception of the family and the family bond, a melodramatic conception of love, a melodramatic conception of art, a melodramatic conception of high art. I don't don't know what's going on with the lighting, but I'm just carrying on. Oblivious. It involves an actor and an actress, al-Halim, Hafiz, and Shadia, between them, with the prince and the princess, melodrama. So I think it's important, as the lights go on and off, to remember and recognize the melodramatic element of this, which I think throws the whole theme of fabrication into a rather interesting light here. It's never quite clear with this film just how seriously one should actually take it. The last thing I want to say about the film and its music and the program this evening is that Lahn al-Wafa, the music was composed by a very distinguished composer of his day, Riyad Sumbati, and it's kind of got everything in it. It's a very rich assemblage of lots of different elements. And like all of the films of this period, it addresses a musically intelligent, a musically well-trained, a musically understanding audience who would have understood the various components. And so in Lahn al-Wafa, you have elements of much older layers of popular Egyptian and classical Egyptian musical culture. You have a layer of tarab, enchantment, of the small ensemble, of the wasl. And we're going to start the program with 10 or 15 minutes of that, so that you have that in your ears before we get to Lahn al-Wafa. A second layer is the layer of the immediately preceding generation, that of Mohammed Abd. And so we have two pieces representing that, including a very one of his early operettas, Majnun Layla. This also forms a layer. And then we come to the 1950s themselves. And then we come to the 1950s. Musical cosmopolitanism in Egypt, with band leaders and arrangers who were able to pull into this musical world Latin American influences, Mediterranean influences, influences from all over the place. So Lahn al-Wafa is also a kind of cosmopolitan soundscape. Now, this cosmopolitan soundscape evaporated in various ways in the ensuing decades, which makes of this moment a certain object of nostalgia. We are inescapably, I think, this evening in a certain kind of nostalgic mode. So with those thoughts in mind, I want to hand over to Reem, who will say something, I think, about the film, the background to the film, and a few other things.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for being here, and it's really an honour to be helping kick off this evening. I have watched Lahn al-Wafa many, many times, and I'm overwhelmed already before it's even been sung. I wanted to just say a few words about the context of much of the music that you're going to hear tonight, especially the second half of the set list. So, the interesting thing about this music is that it's very much associated, as Martin said, with a particular historical moment, a particular political and social context, that of the 1950s and 60s in Egypt and the Arab world. But at the same time, there's been a series of radical political changes since that time, and yet this music has steadfastly outlived it. It's actually become what I would say is part of the national turath, the tradition of music in Egypt, and you could even say that it's part of a pan-national, sort of pan-Arab canon by now. And I can't think of an equivalent in, I was trying to think of an equivalent in the UK or in Europe that has quite this geographical reach and quite this timelessness. So it's well beyond classical music, I would say, Western classical music, because it's so popular. But it doesn't have the short shelf life of a lot of the pop that we listen to. And I don't think I'm exaggerating, but I'll ask Martin in a little moment to comment. So going back to the context for this music, and especially pieces like Lahn al-Wafa, Song of Fidelity. So this was the early 1950s, the beginning of an extraordinary phase in the whole of Arab history, not just Egyptian history. In Egypt, this was the period of the overthrow of the monarchy by a group of army officers who called themselves the Free Officers. who led what they called the July 1952 revolution and who declared a republic in Egypt. Theirs was a state-led project of reform and change, which began, it turned on really the ending of the British occupation, but it then wanted to follow through with decolonizing Egypt and the wider Arab world, trying to eradicate the hierarchies of the colonial era. And this project was led by President Gamal Abdel Nasser, who is well known in the UK for sort of defying Imperial Britain and nationalizing the Suez Canal Company in 1956. But back at home, he was also presiding over what he called a social revolution. So it had elements like land distribution to the poorest peasants, the improvement of workers' conditions to a large degree, the expansion of free education, and the expansion of girls' education and the encouragement of women into the workforce. Now, this was a program for social transformation, obviously from the top down, so it did have its limits. But it was definitely pushing a whole range of socially and religiously even conservative boundaries for its time and trying to erode class divisions. Now these policies, this energy, this message, you can imagine sort of electrified a lot of the artists and the writers at the time in Egypt. Most of them were the product of the education system of the 1930s, but they weren't at ease in that world. They were often marginalized in it, and they were certainly alienated by the British occupation. So for example, al-Halim Hafiz, who's the star of many, you know, the vocalist of many of the songs we'll hear tonight, he was actually an orphan, grew up in an orphanage, and he lived a pretty wretched life until he got into music in his teens, and his talent was discovered in the 1950s. And so, like him, lots of these artists with these sort of modest beginnings threw themselves into promoting the revolution, into singing for it or representing it on screen, and trying to bring its promises of a fair deal into the sort of imaginations, into the living rooms and radios and film screens of a whole generation. So al-Halim was a foremost example. He sang all these patriotic songs about Egypt, but he also sang romantic and sentimental pieces that appealed across the generations. And for fulfilling this role of a sort of revolutionary cultural beacon, he was also invested in by the state. So he would be invited to sing at revolutionary anniversary concerts. And this was true also for the range of stars with whom he was working, so the musicians, the writers, and the composers. But he actually became known as the son of the revolution. July Revolution. Now, these artists together played a sort of interesting dual role in the realm of culture. On the one hand, I think they provided sort of the foundations for which, onto which Egyptians could sort of cling in the middle of all this social and political change. They were there to provide some kind of cultural authenticity while the state was marching forth with these modernization projects. But at the same time, they were also meant to speak to and kind of embody the new Egypt. And although media and the arts were kind of, they were certainly monitored, sometimes even censored in the Nasser era, but within certain parameters, they were actually encouraged to ask pertinent questions of the time. So sort of challenge their audiences to think about where the balance lay or needed to lie between tradition and change and modernity, what sort of attitudes needed to go and what attitudes needed to emerge in order for the revolution to be sort of propelled forward. And so you had this very interesting combination of a sort of centralized state, very powerful state that people were really dependent on, but at the same time with that, a kind of self-empowerment, even collective empowerment that was quite attractive to people, magnetic in that time. And so, as Martin has said, the characteristic of the music of this period is a lot of change and innovation. And you talked about the Latin American influences, other influences in the music that you'll hear. And so you'll hear over this evening
the change from the 18th century.
Is that right? You're starting with music from the
19th century, a century on into the mid 1950s. So that's enough, I think, about the context, but what I wanted to actually put to my co-panelists is what their views are on how we should think about this music today, because it has become, you know, I would wager even more than just nostalgia. Different people are consuming and engaging with this music with different identities, and so it's interesting to wonder quite what that means and how many years and decades are left. I think there are many, and I hope you'll agree with me at the end. So thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's great to see the hall filling up so nicely tonight. Martin and Reem are a tough act to follow, so bear with me. What I'm proposing here is a fairly detailed reading of the film Lahn, al-Wafa, which is not often screened, or in my view, not screened often enough, even though it was al-Halim's cinematic debut, so it's kind of a very important moment, both in Egyptian music history and in cinema history. Revolves around the ideas and language of nation building, or to use a less fashionable phrase, the process of constructing the republic. As Reem pointed out, Egypt hadn't been a republic for very long when this film was made in 1955, and despite the ambitious and very dirigiste orientation of Egypt's young government at the time, the country was still, I think, feeling its way along the path of independent and self-sufficient nation. This, 1955, was the moment of Bandung, of third worldism, the military victory that made Gamal Abdel Nasser a legendary figure was still a year in the future. The arts in general, and cinema in particular, were a key part of that process, as we just heard. But still, if you know the film, you may reasonably object that the plot, namely the story of a music teacher, Ustaz Alam, whose name loosely translated means teacher, Ustaz is the title that we give to our teachers, and Alam comes from the verb Alam, so you know, teacher. So Ustaz Alam, having been betrayed by his wife, recedes into a dark misogynist corner from which he builds a successful career as a musician while simultaneously raising his nephew, Galal, played by al-Halim Hafiz, who in his own turn grows into a gifted musician, but who then proceeds to betray his uncle in his turn. So we go from betrayal to betrayal. And you may reasonably object that this is hardly the stuff of heroic, post-colonial, dynamic nation building. And in the few minutes that I have left, I'll try to convince you otherwise. The film's central conceit is straightforward, that the betrayal of private passions is a political and ethical necessity for national survival. The young lovers that star in the film, Galal and Siham, could only have a future in the new Egyptian Republic by betraying the attachments of the past, thereby shifting society's center of gravity from the nuclear family to the nascent republic. The key mechanism in this context is the promise. This is a film in which people are constantly making and breaking promises. And this is as it should be. In order to exist, this republic needs to be built around institutions that can support and withstand performatives, that can help people keep their promises. Now, again, in political theoretical terms, this is probably a banal point. You can't have a state without government, without laws, without a constitution, without banks, temples, all of which are construed, are built around the same raison d'etre. Namely, that when you swear an oath, when you sign a document, when you use a bank card or a chip and pin card, or whatever, all of these instances are backed up by the state and its institutions, that they're all authorized by the state. But, and this is important, as essential as all of these institutions are to the existence of the state, there must always be an unpredictable, incalculable element if that state is to have a future. Now, this is all very well, you will say, but the link to cinema and music isn't exactly obvious. I contend that cinema operates as part of what we might call, to borrow a phrase, the imagined institution of Egyptian society. This idea, which I'm shamelessly borrowing from the philosopher Cornelius Castoriadis, depends primarily on the word imaginary rather than institution. For Castoriadis, the work of art, the process of speaking, of thinking, of producing and reproducing in words, concepts, and pictures, are all part of the process by which society invents, or as he calls it, institutes itself. Creation and imagination are inseparable from history, during the course of which humanity creates itself, its life, and the social historical matrix in which that life is lived, and from which there emerges an entire universe of meanings. There is, in this perspective, no room for overly deterministic laws of history. Society is its own self-creation and its own self-institution. Now, one good place to see how all this works in practice might be with the title of the film, Lahn al-Wafa. So, usually translated as the Song of Fidelity, or if we want to adopt a more grandiose register, we might call it the Ode of Fulfillment, or the Ode to Fulfillment. The word wafa in Arabic means to fulfill, from the verb wafa. It's a word that crops up repeatedly in Abd al-Halim's lyrics, as in the song, Bukra wa'adu, illu wa'adna hayufi bu'adu. The day after tomorrow, the one who made me a promise will fulfill that promise. And indeed, in a more heroic register, we may note that the last verse of the Egyptian national anthem, Biladi Biladi, describes Egypt's population as being awfiya. Masra awlad al-kiram, awfiya yar'uzna. So from the outset, even the spectator who knows nothing about this film, except the posters that advertise Abd al-Halim and Shadia looking towards a bright new future, will at least expect a plot that bears some relation to, or contains some elements of, promises and fulfillment, demands and responses, vocations and revocations, fidelity and betrayal, all of which are in orbit around the relationship of the citizen to the state. And indeed, all of these variables are in play from the very outset of the film. There are oblique and stilted family relations everywhere. All the characters, mainly musicians that we encounter, Am Alam, his uncle, who dies early in the film, his Qarid friend, Ali Domtul, and so on, are all linked very tenuously to the world that they inhabit. To call them marginal might be a little too easy. It's as if they're not quite marginal. I mean, they have friends, they have reputations, they have families, and so on. But they're not exactly well situated. They're not really where they need to be. They're all, in some way or another, out of place. They are, figuratively and literally, the orphans of the Republic. Galal is orphaned within the first 2 minutes of the film, and when they move to Cairo, Alam's friend Ali Domtul describes the situation of art in Alexandria as being that of an orphan. He says, so it has neither father nor friend. By the end of the film, however, when Galal decides to fulfill, or to complete, his uncle's oratorio, he declares that the musicians in the orchestra are his family. He says to them, "Intu ahli wa khwati," you are my family and my siblings. In other words, the state provides a fitting place for its orphans through its institutions. And we shouldn't forget that these musicians all work for the state conservatory. From the outset, these orphans are surrounded by betrayal. There are broken promises and subverted expectations everywhere. Alam's wife, Mahasin, who doesn't live up to her name, Mahasin means virtues or graces, but in fact she leaves her husband, which is a very ungraceful thing to do. So she abandons her hardworking man, and for a few seconds it looks like he has repaid her departure by departing from the world altogether, although we quickly discover that he's alive. Ustaz Alam quickly breaks into a misogynist rant that defines his character. How can his love be repaid by his wife's betrayal? And indeed, how can God repay his virtuous behavior by allowing such dreadful things to happen? None of this, however, prevents the production and circulation of further promises. So, on his deathbed, Alam's uncle makes him promise to take care of his son, Galal, and to dedicate himself to art rather than material success. Alam keeps these promises, of course, and in doing so generates further promises. There's a very interesting scene in which basically everyone he meets, and this everyone is exemplified by the man who sells him his daily bowl of fava beans, of food, predicts a brilliant future for him in exchange for the fact that he's taking such good care of Galal. But again, not all the promises are kept. Alam's uncle makes him promise not to be arrogant, a promise that Alam breaks early and often, and which operates as the tragic flaw in his personality. Alam's idealism constantly lapses into the very arrogance that he was warned against. As the film moves forward, the promises proliferate. Alam assumes his destiny as the nation's musical pedagogue and foremost composer, turning away from the world of commercial awalim and belly dancers in order to teach the nation what he calls a clean language, kalam nadif. And the only place where he can do that, of course, is through the state's institution, the National Musical Institute, where he says he will lead the choral musician to greater heights of artistic glory. And all the while, he keeps his promise to his nephew Galal, who himself makes good on his promise. In his very first cinematic scene of his entire career, we see Abd al-Halim Hafiz rushing out of the gates of Cairo University and saying to his uncle, "Congratulate the uncle, I passed." And again, this is a theme that will recur quite frequently in al-Halim's musical and cinematic career. If you think of the song Wahiyat Albi Wa Afrahu, which is played every time anybody passes an exam in Egypt of any kind, of any significance, you'll see what I mean. In fact, nearly all of al-Halim's songs in this film handle words and ideas that he returns to later. One of his first musical numbers is the song La Talumni, Don't Blame Me, which prefigures Bitlumuni Le, his later hit, Why Do You Blame Me? And in fact, this particular song, La Talumni, is laden with meaning as it operates like a kind of mise en abîme of the film's title. In, at one point in the song, the lyrics say, if I fill the air with song, don't blame me, for the song of fidelity, Lahn al-Wafa, is in my mouth. He says, Fi femi Lahn al-Wafa. Let me now move on to my conclusion. The final musical number of the film, and the one we're going to hear this evening, the way it's shot, it operates as a kind of late Rousseauian Feast of the Republic. This is the only reading I can think of that explains the very odd combination of costumes and props. All the dancers are wearing evening clothes, you know, so all the guys are sort of in white tie tuxedos, and all the women are in evening dresses, but they all have these really strange baskets of flowers that they're carrying everywhere. So it's a mixture of registers. And I think, you know, one coherent explanation would be that this is the Feast of Virtue, the Feast of the Republic. And the lyrics of Lahn al-Wafa, especially the ones that are sung by Shadia, the female lead, all simultaneously emphasize, on the one hand, the fulfillment of desire, but also the unpredictability of the future. In particular, if you think of the line, Taba al-Zaman ghadru aman, it is the nature of time, it is the nature of being alive, to have moments of security and insecurity. There are no guarantees in life. The message, of course, of all this is clear. The future exists precisely because of its unpredictability. You can't completely calculate or control the future. Ustaz Alam's misogyny and desperate attempts at protecting himself from disappointment are revealed for what they are, namely ways of foreclosing the future, of preventing the future. The future cannot be calculated, and banning women won't keep them from existing. All it can do is condemn the person who desires that ban to an early grave. As the young lovers, Galal and Siham, sort of Egypt's Tamino and Pamina, sing their way into this bright and promising future, surrounded by singers and dancers, the choreography reminds us that republics operate as a kind of machine that are constantly making and unmaking people's attachments to each other. Far from being defined only by rigid laws and institutions, the republic depends on the aleatory character of song, dance, and performance. Thank you very much.
I have an answer and a question, and the answer is to Reem's question, which is how and why this music continues to be salient. I think the point that I'd want to make here is that subsequent generations have each found a way of appropriating this music and bending it to their own will. In the late Mubarak period, the political repertory here was recuperated in a one might say, a rather heavy-handed way. The music has found a way of continuing to exist in the post-Tahrir environment as well. So there is something about this music, about its prolixity, I suppose it would be the word that I would use, that explains something about how people find things in it. And the question to Ziad is about the melodramatic element of this. Is it just with today's eyes that final sequence with the bizarre mise-en-scene, is it only today's eyes that see it as absurd, as melodramatic, as just implausible, as emotionally kind of questionable at a certain level? Or is this to see things with too contemporary eyes? I mean, how does one deal with it? I mean, the question of melodrama and sentimentality, I think, might trouble, I think, some of the ways in which you're suggesting we look at it.
Well, I think the thing about that last scene and the sort of, in fact, Reem and I were talking about this earlier, that there's a lot of really strange, awkward moments throughout this film, and that may be one reason why it doesn't get much screening. But the curious choreography at the very end, I think, is one remarkable instance where we see Egypt instituting itself. In other words, we see on the one hand, the language of what one might call, you know, interwar fashion, because that really is where the clothing comes from, it seems to me. But at the same time, this Feast of the Republic combined with that, as a way of saying that this is the new Egypt. We haven't completely abandoned everything. We haven't completely betrayed everything that came before us. We're just taking what will serve our purposes. But then again, that's a very superficial view. On the question of melodrama and of sentiment, I think there's no getting around melodrama in any narrative of emancipation. I think that's just become the language of emancipation ever since the 18th century. And I think this is something that operates in a cross-cultural register now. If you look at the way soap operas and telenovelas operate throughout the world, it's really all about the tears. And I think the tears aren't there just for sort of indulgent emotional reasons. I think it's because this is the index of somebody being set free, somebody being let go, somebody being allowed to spread their wings and fly. And that operates as a kind of signal to the audience that, you know, this is a good thing has happened now.
I guess I wanted to ask Ziad about redemption. There is some redemption for al-Halim at the end, and there's some way in which al-Halim, teacher, who shows up. Did you mention the way he shows up in the song? Yeah, so it's very melodramatic, and he is in the wings, and he's weeping, and he's feeling fulfilled by the young generation. But he has let them go, you know, but they accept him back. So I feel that as a father, so I'm wondering how that speaks in both of your views to this, you know, the way in which the Republic deals with tradition, deals with the old.
Actually, it's really the cinematography of that last sequence is astounding, because basically teacher has a conversation with Ali Dunkel, his old friend who's played brilliantly by Abdulaziz Asad. And basically he says, you know, he repeats the rant that he began the film with. He says, oh, how could she do this to me? I loved her, blah, blah, blah. And his friend says, look, she did you a favor. I mean, let it go, get on with your life. It wouldn't have lasted anyway. And that really changes everything. So it's as if the iteration of that moment where he bewails his fate suddenly allows the future to exist. And then we see him walking the streets of Cairo. He sees a poster advertising the al-Wafa event. And in the poster that he sees isn't the one that we see here. It's a poster of him in all his glory, basically, you know, a fictional poster. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, very good. And then as he walks, and then the camera sort of cuts to a scene of nighttime Cairo, presumably at Galat Bridge. And then we see a picture of the opera. And in the shot of Galat Bridge, it's all very dark. You just see a sort of a row of lights. And then at the extreme right-hand side of the screen, you see one word, which is Gomhuriyet, Republic. And that's it. So in a way, he's rushing into the state's institution that is making this new Egypt. And I think it's really very well put together, but you kind of have to look out for it. Yeah.
This is, as I'm sure you already can see, a musical and a cultural world that generates thinking and ideas and conversation, and this panel was very impromptu, and I'm sitting here thinking we really need to talk more about this, you guys, and I'm sure we will find a moment. We are going to switch now to the musical part of the program, about an hour's program we have ahead of you, but there'll be a little bit of chair moving, but as we do this, could I ask you just to join with me in thanking Reem and Ziad very much for their wonderful talks. If people would like to there's a lot to see here, and I know at the back it's rather difficult to see, so if you want to creep around the sides, if you're happy standing on your feet, please do that.
Well, good evening, everyone. After all the talk about the 1950s and the big crescendo, as I guess, and all associated with it, which is primarily about this evening, is about. We thought to just, I always like to put a little perspective on things. So to just look a little perspective on how music moved on in that time, in the 40s and the 50s, and the big band and the orchestral work. I thought it'd be nice to perhaps give you a slice of what it was like before these times. So in the late 19th century, early 20th century, and this will be a very brief taster of what that stuff was, the world of Muashahat and Sama'is and Adwar, and it was another world with all its tradition and all its culture. So we will start you off with that. I'd like to introduce some guests of Maqam this evening. Mr. Giles Lewin, over there on the violin. Hello. Mr. Wael Abu Bakr. Mr. Farouk Al-Safi. Martin Stokes, of course, you know, Mr. Martin Stokes, the man who fears nothing. And, of course, my beautiful vocalist, Bissiara Salahuddin. My character.
Says what?
This man, Minna Kassim Bayad.
Thank you. So we did a very just a small section from a very famous Arabic sama'i called Sama'i Bayati by Ibrahim al-Aryan, Qanun player. And then we proceeded to sing Muwashah, Imla' al-Aqdah. It's a very old Muwashah, also in the mode of Bayati. Then on to some Taqseem, and Yar so beautifully sang Adores, composed by Mohammed Osman, one of the most prominent, if not the most prominent Egyptian composer of the 19th century, or at least second half of the 19th century. And although a wasla in its, or a suite of song in the way it was presented maybe 120, 130 years ago would entail some more, I don't have the time this evening to go for a more expansive thing. So that was just a taste of what things sounded like and what sort of flavor you'd expect from that sort of era. And then came the late 1920s and the birth, the musical birth, if you like, of Mohammed Abd al-Wahhab. And a genre that was very cool, I guess, in its time. It was certainly selling a lot of records, and that was the monologue. So up until that time, a monologue is either something quite melodramatic sung within a play, a musical play, such as the stuff by Salah Mahjazi and people like that of the Egyptian theatre, or comical. But a serious kind of love song that's sung by just one individual singer all the way through with a lot of light and shade and it stops and starts and melodrama. That genre, the monologue, pretty much started with Umm Kulthum and Abdul Wahab in, say, 1928, 1929. And the one I'm about to do for you now is one of those examples, one of the early examples, actually, of the form of monologue from which then film, songs, and everything else built on. This is called Lila Mahili, composition by Mohammed Abd al-Wahhab. And the lyrics, although colloquial Arabic, are written by none other than Ahmed Shawki Beg himself, the famous lead Egyptian poet.
Thank you.
So we're going to fast forward, what, in 10 years or so, isn't it? Majnun Layla, al-Wahhab's unfinished opera, I guess. He did an excerpt from a movie called Nasserite, where he, of course, this is al-Wahhab composition, Ahmed Shawki's reimagination of the story of Qais and Layla. Just that no one gets like a fright of a lifetime or anything. I will be doing the role of Qais and Layla's father. Due to lack of personnel. Someone courageous enough to do that, you'll see more. But just so that you know.
Thank you. Oh.
Okay, and then from this point, then we're going to fast forward to Abd al-Halim Hafiz. And the summer of 1954, a little song known as al-Shur absolutely exploded on Egyptian radio. Sazwael told me a story that he heard from Abdulaziz Mahmoud, who was a singer, you know, very famous singer, movie star, late 40s, early 50s. One of a few that started a new generation of film star come singers. I'll let Sazwael tell that if you were to say in Arabic, and then I will say in English. No? Abdulaziz Mahmoud. قال له سجوال قال له احنا اول ما سمعنا على قد الشو مين اللي جابهم لعبد العزيز محمود قال عبد الغني السيد عبد الغني السيد انا والله السيد قال له قال له قبل مع بعض قال لهم في واد جديد بيغني اغنيه اسمها على قد الشو هيقعدنا كلنا في البيت يا سو بيسكلي عبد الغني السيد سينج از تول ا جروب اوف ذا اذر سينجرز هو بروميننت ان ذات تايم I've just heard this new kid with a new song called Al Adli Show on the radio. We're all going to be out of a job very soon. And, true to that, I mean, he was unparalleled, really. So this is the song that made Abd al-Halim, if you like, start his career off, genuinely. Al Adli Show. Thank you. اسمع اصلي اسمراني ولا اصفر ملك روحي
Thank you. Thank you.
moment we've all been waiting for, I guess, yes. This is the song that this evening is all about, and this is called Lahn al-Wafa. Martin Stokes. Martin Stokes, everyone. I don't know about you, but me personally, one day I'm going to look back at this and say, once upon a time, I played and I walked there with the great Martin Stokes. This is a great man, he really is. And I'm privileged to know him and be his friend, as well as I'm so privileged to play with all these amazing musicians. Everyone, every single one of them, just so talented and clever people. And Mr. Giles Lewin over there, he's so good, he's great, he's never to be here. Mr. White, I'm watching as well over there. I mean, who in the Arab scene here doesn't know White Level Buck? An amazing violinist, of course. Mr. Farooq Safi as well. The governor, I love the boys. Sexiest man behind the piano I've ever seen. William. Oh, yeah. Oliver, of course, on the bass guitar here from Stornoway. So, you know, we also bring star-quality and celebrity.